Okay, so once again, good evening, everyone. Thanks for being here. So we're going to start with, we're already going to start. So you all have your pizzas, hopefully that keeps you happy for a while. Okay, so today's topic is going to be about DevOps. And actually what we're going to do is, I'm going to show you hands-on how to create an entire DevOps pipeline end-to-end, right? From start, from scratch, all the way to a full CI/CD kind of model. But before we do that, before I actually show you how to create from scratch, we're just going to go through a few slides just to, you know, show you the context. And we are also going to show you a ready-made, you know, DevOps project that's already well-oiled and it's already running. So just to kind of let you see how the entire thing looks like before I show you, you know, how it's being done from scratch. Okay, so this was a report done by Puppet Labs sometime, I think, 2-3 months ago. It talks about how the high-performing organizations, as compared to the low performers, right, they are able to deploy, right, 200 times more frequently, and when they do so, they deploy it faster, right? There's this term here called lead time, which is basically from the time you check in your code to the time it shows up in your production environment, or to the time where your customers and your users get to use it, right? So the number here, I know it's quite astounding. It's almost an extreme scenario over here, right? 2,500 times faster. So if a high-performing team takes 1 hour, right, to make the deployment, if the lead time is 1 hour, a low-performing team will take 3 months. I mean, that's just the disparity over there. If you can just shout out in your own organizations, in your own, you know, teams or your own projects, how long does it take for code to get from check-in to production? Any?
2 weeks.
2 weeks. Okay. Anyone longer than 2 weeks? No? Oh, so 2 weeks is about. So the rest, a few days, 1 week. Sounds about there, you're right? You have a few environments in between, from dev all the way to production. So it varies, right, from organization to organization, from team to teams. So this is what it is. So when we talk about Microsoft's DevOps solution, we can't, you know, shout this enough. It is any app, any platform, any developer. You know, it's not just .NET only, much to, you know, what a lot of people used to think. So it supports a whole range of platforms with a whole variety of languages. It does a whole bunch of different stuff, right? A lot of people start using it, especially TFS. So there's two variants, right? TFS and team services. Basically, one is on-prem, one is on cloud. Has anyone used TFS here? Yes, a couple. Team services? Yes, lesser. The only difference is that TFS is kind of like the younger brother of team services, in the sense that team services gets updated every 3 weeks, TFS is every 3 months. Okay? So you might be familiar with this. This is the Converge DevOps lifecycle, right? This is just showing you the union between both life cycles, the dev and IT operations. Okay, so I'm going to take you through this example, right? This is what I'm going to take you through, walk you through. I will show you this ready-made, and then I will show you how it's done from scratch. Okay, so first we look at the business user, right? If you look at any organization, some organizations, we have an internal, like a help desk or ticketing system. That's where they can go in, they can raise requests, they can submit a change request, or they can submit a bug. So you have things like that. And then we have that system integrated with team services. That's where it comes down to the backlog. And that's where the dev team will pick it up. All right, it will, you know, start working on that change request, check the code in, and it will trigger off a build. Okay? Within the build portion, there are a few things that we can do typically, right? You can do you know, things like your unit testing, you can check your code analysis, you can do some technical debt tracking, I think these are some of the things that you can do when your as your application is being built or as part of the build process. After it's being built, the output of that, right? So for example, if it's a web application, the output is a web deployment file. If it's a desktop application, in a Windows platform, you get a .exe, right? So you get some kind of a binary. You put it into what we call a artifact repository. So an artifact repository is something that stores all your different binaries, all your builds, right? So you can choose to, you know, go back and do a rollback, you know, for on previous builds if you would like. And then that's where you do deployments, right? Into, in this case, in this example, four different environments. After that, when you have your app in production, that's where you do monitoring, right? Monitoring constitutes to a huge part of the whole DevOps lifecycle, right? Monitoring is what gives you the ability to be able to say, okay, this feature is being used the way I've intended it. Users are not using it. You know, it drives your backlog, right? Based on the kind of information that you get from the data in production. All right, so let's take a look at team services. Okay, so we're going to start with this. All right, so this is my ticketing system. I'm using, in this case, Zendesk. And I have here someone that has already created a ticket. So this is a colleague of mine that has created a ticket with this particular request at the bottom. All right, so this is created in Zendesk. And there is out-of-the-box integration from Zendesk to VSTS. Okay, so what I can do now, so I'm gonna change hats to be someone of like a, you know, a developer lead of something like that. So I log into this system, I see this is a change request, and this looks, you know, like it's something reasonable that I would want my team to work on. So I would say, okay, I would say, I'm gonna link this up, new work item. I will choose the correct project. This is a task, and I will copy the description, right, of the ticket. Right, so this was what was created, and I'll say, okay, create work item. So moving over here, okay, I'm going to this project. I would then see, so I have pinned a widget over here. You can see from Zendesk, it shows me one, right? So as a team lead, I log on to team services. I can see the new requests that have come in. So right here, I can see there's one new request that has been, you know, pushed from Zendesk. I can look at the historical data. So I can see that, you know, at the bottom here, I have completed four tasks already. One of them is new. So I can click on this, and it will show me the task that has been created. Okay, so this is what has been requested by the end user. The text is here, and I can choose to then, you know, assign it to someone to work on. All right, so this is that integration. I can choose to, have you seen the backlog of team services? Are you familiar with it?
Yes.
Yes. So this is the backlog. You can choose to customize the processes as you like. Let me just launch Visual Studio. Okay, so now that I have already assigned the task to a developer, okay, I'm going to switch hats again. So now I'm wearing a hat of a developer, right? So a developer lives and breathes in Visual Studio, right? They don't go anywhere else. In some cases, they don't even log in into team services. So I have launched Visual Studio, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to change make some changes, right? As though I'm actually working on the task that has been assigned to me. So the app in question looks like this, Contoso Sports. Right, this is the site that has been deployed. This environment over here is QA. Okay, this is QA. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to change I'm going to change this text over here, right? This Hello DevOps. I'm going to change it to something else. So I am going to find that file. Okay, let me just change this to Hello World. Okay, so I've changed this. I'm going to commit this, change text. And I will push this into my source control, right? My repository. I have set this up as a Git repository. So Team Services supports Git. So coming over here, back to Team Services, if I go over to builds, you will see that it is now in progress. All right, so I have set up what we call a CI build. So it has, after the check-in, has triggered this process. So we can take a look and see exactly what's going on. So let's click on this and see what's happening. And you see that I'm somewhere in the middle. The first three steps have been completed, and it's just going down the different steps that I've configured my build to execute. Right? So if I click edit on this, so let's exactly see the steps that I've configured. So these are the different steps that I have. So for those of you who are .NET developers, this will not look foreign, right? First, I restore my NuGet packages. And then I am preparing my source code to be scanned by SonarQube. Does anyone use SonarQube here? No? Okay, so for those who are not sure what SonarQube is, SonarQube basically does static code analysis on my code base. And at the end of a scan, it will tell me whether if there are any vulnerabilities, if there are any bugs, if there are any design practices that I should follow based on the rules that I've configured. Right, so SonarQube is a third-party service. It's nothing, you know, it's not related to Team Services, but we have integration with SonarQube. Out of the box. Yep. So I have I built my solution. I run my unit tests, and then I'm copying over here a couple of deployment scripts, and at the end of that, I publish my build artifacts. Right. So at the end of that, I take my web deployment file because this is a web application. And I push it into the artifact repository. Okay, so let's go back and see if our build is completed. I think it is. Yep, so you can see here it has succeeded. So this was completed 71 seconds ago, and this was the one that was just triggered. And we can see that the build summary page does give us a bit of details. It tells us how many tests pass, none of them fail. It gives us code coverage. So this is really, really helpful. There are some teams who enforce a certain percentage of code coverage. So say, like, for example, 50%, right? So if it falls below that level, the whole build fails. So it's good, I guess, for some team leads, but I guess developers who don't really do unit testing wouldn't really warm up to such a restriction. And you will see that at the bottom over here, it has already gone ahead to deploy to my dev environment. Okay, so this is already on the way. So let's move on and take a look at our release. Okay, so looking from this screen alone, you probably can just kind of deduce a couple of things, right? First, you see there are four boxes. So that kind of suggests there are four environments, which is the case. I have dev, I have QA, I have UAT, and production. Okay, you will see some of them, some of my deployments failed, right? The ones that show up In red, those are failed deployments. And you see some of them shows up in orange. So that means the deployment was successful, but, right? What the but is, you got to go and see the logs, right? What does team services tell you? So I can click on this, the one that is currently active, my currently active deployment. And okay, so I can see that dev has already succeeded. And it is pending an approval for QA. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and just approve this first. So let's just approve this, and then I'll show you what's going on. So if I were to edit this now, so you see this is where I have configured the environments. Right, this is where the configuration is done. Configuration is done once, and then thereafter, you know, if you check in the code, it just follows through the whole pipeline. So if we were to look at dev, okay, so there are a few steps I'm doing over here, right? So first, I'm doing what we call tokenization. So that is, so when you take a web application and you deploy it to multiple environments, there are a few things that you need to be aware of, right? So one is the connection string is different from dev to QA to UAT, right? Connection strings are different. Application settings are different. So the tokenization task over here basically configures the application with the correct parameters to be deployed in that environment. So that every time you do a deployment, it will always use the correct variables, the correct parameters and settings for that environment. So that is done over here. Then I'm doing a deployment. So this is the actual task that does the deployment. And thereafter, I'm doing some cleanup task that is Azure specific. Okay, so this is in dev. In QA, the first four tasks are the same, but the last three are testing related. Right. So if I go back to this slide over here, you see that in QA, you know, I may want to perform some functional tests, some automated tests, some performance tests. So that's exactly what I'm doing here. I have configured these tests to run in my QA environment. Okay, so while I'm letting that run, I'm going to open up another window. I'm going to put this side by side here. The reason why I'm doing this side by side is, so in one of my tasks, I'm actually running a UI test, automated UI test, okay, using Selenium. Anyone is familiar with Selenium? So the machine on my right is a virtual machine that runs my Selenium test. So I'm just putting it side by side so that you can see as my deployment is going on the way, you will see browsers starting to pop up automatically, right? It will run my UI test. And early on, you also saw that it required someone to approve, right? So this is because I have set the QA team, which I'm in, to approve before a deployment can happen. Okay, so there are two concepts over here. One is a pre-deployment approval, one is a post-deployment approval. Okay, so pre before means before anything can be deployed, you know, this person or group of people has to acknowledge. Post means after it's been deployed, then someone has to come and verify to say that, okay, this looks good. Okay, so you see the my virtual machine on the right, a VM, a test runner has kind of been launched. Let me just close this and move this here. Okay, over here is where you see my variables. So these variables, these settings, you can see my connection string here, you see my FTP user and password is with respect to QA. All right, so this changes from environment to environment. So if I were to show you my dev settings, the values would be different. Okay. So let's move on. Okay, so let me just pause and take a look and see what's happening over here. So I can view the logs. I can see in real time what's happening. So I can see I am at this step over here. So, yep, so you can see on the right, so you can see a browser has just popped up. It's loading a page. You will see clicks starting to happen automatically, and then it will just run my tests, right? So for those who have not seen or tried automated UI testing, sometimes this may even look magical to some degree. Okay, so let me put that over here and come back to this. Okay, so this is all my tests. So after my UI test is done, I have configured Team Services to run a performance test, right? So I'm going to run a load test. Yeah, sure.
Where do you configure the test agent?
The test agent. So over here, so you can see that I have deployed the test agent, right? So that's the first step. So you, this deploys the test agent to that VM that you saw earlier, this one that is this one here. So it is based on these settings, right? My machines. So this is an example of a variable being used. So you can see this variable over here. If I go to my configure variables, which is this one here, right? Test VM machine, fully qualified domain name. This is the domain name of that machine, that VM that you saw earlier where the browsers was popping up. So this is how I've configured it. So I've configured this here. And the test that I'm going to run happens in this folder called Selenium Tests. So in the VM, I have my test over there that I've copied. This is the test that it will just run. Yeah. Okay. Is that, have I answered your question? Or?
Yeah.
Okay, so for my load tests, I'm, you know, the settings I've chosen is something quite you know, light, right? 25 user, you know, hammering my application for about 60 seconds. Just, you know, this is for demo, right? But if you want something a bit more, you can increase this. So this is a very simple load test, right? This is a very, you know, a single URL load test. You can choose to have something a bit more complicated, right? If you want to record a scenario of, say, a login scenario, right? So that involves multiple clicks. It involves a post, a request. You can do that with Visual Studio as well. But if it's going to be a simple single URL test, you can do it from right within this interface. Okay, so if we go on to UAT, let's see UAT. UAT, nothing happens here. UAT, in fact, if you look at the steps, it's the same as dev. So in UAT, we are going to do some what we call user testing. That means an actual user will come on and do some testing. So I don't think at this point in time you can really automate everything. There are still certain tests that requires user intervention, whether it's to do a visual check. So a story was told of an e-commerce company that had full automation, so all their tests were automated, and one of the developers modified a CSS file, right, to change the color of the button text to another color, right? So they put that through the different pipelines, all the tests passed, it goes into production, and they found out that people were not completing their transactions, right? They keyed in all the details, but they were not actually completing the transactions. So upon a visual confirmation, they found out that the developer who had changed the text of the color text of the button had changed the color such that the foreground and background color were the same. Right? So these are, you know, just, you know, an example of why, you know, to some degree visual checks are still, you know, necessary. Okay, so let's take a look at our deployment progress. It's still deploying. Let's see, it's still in progress. Let's take a look at the logs and see where we're at. So, oh, okay, it's still, oh, it's almost done. Okay, so now it's deploying into UAT. Yep, so UAT is on its way. Okay, So now, okay, so in the interest of time, instead of waiting for UAT to be completed, I'm going to launch a browser. And let's assume UAT is completed, right? So I'm going to take this URL. And let's assume that I'm a UAT tester and I need to test the site that has been deployed in the UAT environment, right? So one of the things I can do is with the use of a plugin we call test feedback. So scenario is this, right? UAT tester tests the site, you know, starts testing, comes across a bug, and then tries to tell the developer that, hey, I found a bug. So developer very naturally asks, how do you replicate it? But then the UAT tester may say, you know, I can't remember, or I can't seem to replicate it again. So what I'm going to show you helps with scenarios exactly like that. So I'm going to say, I'll go to the store, and then I'll choose one of these, and then I'll say add to cart, and I'll say checkout. Okay, so now I'm at the checkout page. So okay, so I'm wearing a hat of a UAT tester now, right? So let's say I find out a problem with this page, right? Let's assume that the amount here in the checkout page, in the order summary, does not tally with what I saw in the product catalog, right? So I want to raise this as a bug. So what I can do here is I can go over to this plugin. I can take a screenshot like this. So let's say I take a screenshot like this. I can start annotating this, and I say price is incorrect, right? And I say okay, and I will go ahead and create a bug. So you can see over here, all the steps that I've clicked through shows up in in the sequence that I've went through them, right? So the entire session of my browsing of what I click shows up here. I can choose to create a new bug, so I can say price is incorrect, and I'll say save. So what happens now is that after I click save, the bug that you saw over there gets sent to the backlog. Right, so you look right at the bottom over here, you will see price is incorrect. And if I click on that, you can see all the different steps that I took all shows up as part of the work item. I can even see the user agent details, right? What browser, what OS, and things like that, right? So as a team leader now, right, coming into team services, I just need to select, right, who I want to assign it to. Let's say I assign it to my colleague. Save and close.
Any automatic relationship to current build that is tested?
Sorry?
Any relationship to build that is tested by this user?
Yes.
In a bug.
Yes.
So
if you look over here, this plugin. So okay, so this plugin is available for Chrome and Firefox. Edge is coming out soon.
Not IE.
No IE.
What no.
It's called test and feedback. Yeah, test and feedback. So Chrome, Firefox, and Edge coming soon. Moving forward, there'll be no further enhancements done for IE, except for maybe security vulnerabilities. But in terms of development like this, no. Yes. Yeah.
You're not going to create this for IE at all.
No. No. Yeah. If you want to do testing in the way I show you, yeah, use either Chrome, Firefox, or Edge.
How does the test knows that is project going?
Yeah, so you can configure it over here. So I've already, configured it beforehand. So I have, yeah, this
so
is where.
Every time I do a new project, I
change. Yep, correct. Or if you're testing against the same project, then you don't have to change that.
This works on the on-prem DFS also?
Yes, this works on the on-prem as well. Yeah. No, it's developed by Microsoft. Yeah, it's a Microsoft tool. So you can still use the test and feedback plugin that you see over here. And you see that there are two modes, right? Connected and standalone. So for whatever reason, if say you are not using TFS or Team Services as a platform, you can choose the standalone mode. So it will capture all the sessions, like all the different clicks, and you can save it into a HTML or PDF file, I think. Yeah, and then you can then email that file out to your developers, assuming that you do not, you know, you're not on TFS or Team Services, and thus, you know, can't have that integration. So that's another way you can use this. No IE, no IE at all. Yeah, any version of IE, no IE. Yeah. Do you all still use IE?
Yeah.
Huh? Okay. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But we do see people moving away from IE. Okay. So let me just refresh this and see where we are at. Let's see. Okay, so deployment to UAT is complete. So in UAT, I have enforced a post-deployment approval. So that means that the deployment is already done. So as a UAT, you know, person, right, sometimes you do sign off, right, to say that, okay, the UAT is good. So this can be a form of that. I can say approve. And then finally, it moves into production. Okay, so production also requires, I mean, production being production, of course, you would want someone to approve it. So you can see that it requires another approval, which I would then approve. And that, you know, if we were to just, okay, revisit this slide again, concludes deployment all the way to production. Any questions here?
So it takes binaries from one environment to another, just substitute these connection strings, right?
Yes, in my example, yes, that's all I'm doing. Connection strings and some FTP login, because different environments, I have different passwords.
But binaries, as you say?
Binaries is the same, yes. Yep, yes.
Approval-wise, is there a way to select if the person not around, backup person?
Approval, yeah, yes. So the question is, can you select multiple approvers, and if someone doesn't approve, there's a backup? Answer to that is yes. So if I were to go back to the approvers, more options, you can see these are my options. Okay, I can say all users have to approve in sequential order, or as long as any one user approve, then the approval is considered valid. Yep, so these are the few options that you have.
Maybe my VP needs to approve before yourself.
Yeah.
But my VP is not on that day.
Yeah.
And someone has backup, but then now I have to, who can
feedback? Oh, no. Then in that case, no. Yeah, so you are, the currently the options that you have are only these three options. Yeah. Yeah.
What if, let's say, for example, it breaks my UAT? Okay. And I want to roll back to the previous version.
Right.
So how do I does it have to be a separate?
Okay. So Team Services. Okay. So when we talk about rollback, rollback is usually a very tricky thing to handle, right? In this example, I don't even have databases. So with Team Services, you can do a schema compare, for example. Right, you get the delta, right? So let's say if I'm adding a new column or a new field, I get the delta and then I deploy that into my environments. So when we talk about rolling back, right, if you have to do a database rollback, right, something, things like this are very complex. So what TFS or Team Services supports is what we call a roll forward model. So you go back to a previous build. So we have this thing called the artifact repository, right? So if you were to look at all the builds, you see the different builds over here. So you choose the previous build, and then you do a deployment again. So we kind of call it a roll forward in that sense. If you, you have to do it manually. Yes, it has to be done manually.
So we still don't have something like automatic snapshot changes, whatever.
So yeah, yes, you can. So we have this thing called, so if you're using Microsoft SQL, we have this thing called DECPACS, which is a snapshot of the database's schema. So each time you do a release, you can take a snapshot of that particular schema, and you can just redeploy that schema again. You can do that.
But data, we'll lose that data, right?
Yes. Yeah.
That's true. The kind of features that I expect from new TFS, it's like I click to previous build,
yeah,
and Azure automatically revert from previous snapshot, from snapshot of previous build,
yeah,
revert all my affected machines,
right,
and then I just move back to my previous snapshot.
Yeah, currently, so currently you can do that,
so
but
it
would
be
still,
very nice.
Yeah, that would be, I agree, that would be nice. But currently that's still a little bit manual in that sense, yeah.
Because we have a lot of PowerShell scripts doing the stuff for us,
right,
but maintaining it, it's just a pain for
me. Maintaining the PowerShell,
connected together, so
yeah,
short, all the,
I mean, you can use Team Services to execute your PowerShell scripts,
yeah,
if you want. Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah.
How about what one here is that you're on point on QA or PPD, then there's the data
environment.
How do I proceed? There are now two phones.
So it already deployed into production?
No, on PPD or your UAT.
Or UAT, you find there's a defect.
That's
so,
I'm building a new module,
okay,
on UAT now.
Is
but
UAT?
Now my current production has a defect.
Okay.
So that means that I need to fix the production for what the UAT to on testing.
Okay.
How do I approach that?
So that would be more of branching, I would think. So that would be more of the way you do a branch. So if you were to think about that, how I would approach it is, so, right, you're right, right? So I have the latest branch that I'm working on, right, which is now in UAT. I find there's something wrong with, so that depends, right? When you create that new feature, are you creating in a new branch? Typically, we do recommend whenever you're creating a new feature, you always branch, right? That's the thing when you use Git as well, right? You want to create a new feature, you branch. Everything you do, you branch, right? Very rarely you would, integrate features back into the branch without ensuring that it is really stable. So with a correct branching strategy, so you can create multiple builds, build definitions over here on different branches. So in that sense, so if I have a feature branch that is in UAT, and I find out that my main branch has a bug, I can go back to my main branch, fix it, and then it will just be pushed all the way to deployment production while my feature branch in UAT still sits there, and then I can merge it back when everything is stable.
You need to merge back my UAT again, because my testing will fail right now.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, yes. Yeah, that's what you would have.
He's also referring to a hotfix.
Yeah.
Hotfix is another branch. Huh?
Yeah. Okay, so what I'm going to show you now is from scratch. Okay, so this should take about, I guess, I hope, in 20 minutes. In creating a blank Team Services project with full CI/CD. Okay, so we're going to try that. It's kind of just to show how easy, of course, in my demo sample, it is to really start, get started, and to really set up something like that. Right? It's not something that is so you need to spend 2 months on to get started. Okay, so I'm gonna go to my project home. I'm gonna close this, and I'm gonna create a new project. I'm gonna call this end-to-end DevOps demo. Okay, that's the name of my project. And I will say, okay, everything else looks good. Let me just say create. So this is the new project creation template. So currently I'm on what we call insider preview, so I get to see something like this. So if you are using Team Services, don't be alarmed if you don't see the same UI as I am. Okay, so this is what I see over here. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to initialize a README file. So I'm going to say initialize to start with a README file. So README gives me some information on my project. So do any of you really get Markdown? Like really, like back in the day when I started development, it's like markup, right? And then now it's, I still prefer markup. In any case, so the inbuilt editor inside Team Services is pretty decent. So you can see I'm editing my Markdown file. I can commit this, I can save. And the one thing about Team Services is it kind of handholds you along the way, right? In the things that you need to do, right? So right from this page, you see, it kind of prompts me to say that, hey, you know, do you want to set up your CI? All right, so I can click on, okay, set up build. Notice that I have not even checked in any code yet, right? I'm just going with the flow, right? I create my project. What it prompts me to do, I'm just kind of going with the flow with what Team Services is asking me to do. So I'm going to say that, okay, so the end result of this is I want to do a deployment into Azure. So I'll say next. Okay, everything looks good. So the thing about Team Services is that it integrates with the different source control systems, right? So if you're still using SVN, it does integrate. If you have your own remote or private Git, it integrates with that, right? You don't have to say that, okay, if I use VSTS, I have to use all of VSTS. It doesn't work that way. You can if you want, but you have the option of choice as well. So okay, I'll say create. So this is the template that, you know, have kind of populated the steps for me. The basic .NET stuff, right? NuGet restore, build a solution, run my unit tests, do a deployment, and then publish the artifacts. So you notice something, that the deployment actually happens within the build, right? So you have the flexibility to do that as well, right? You can choose a deployment step to take place as part of a build process, right? But of course, if you have this inside here, you lose the ability to control things like the approvers, the different environments. So if you want something quick and dirty, you can get started with this. But I'm going to remove this for now because we want to really roll out a proper CD kind of a pipeline. Okay. Let's see what else I can do here. I can say create a work item on failure, right? So if someone checks in the code and it fails the build, it creates a work item as a bug and assigns it back to that developer, right? So this is something that I would like to have. The rest, I think I will just leave it as default, and I'll say save.
How can you assign to developer, because build can contain several commits?
Right.
So which developer?
The developer that the commit that is made by that developer.
The latest commit to trigger build.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Correct. So I'm gonna call this say CI and say okay. Okay, so I have saved this already. Okay, so I'm going to just take a step back, and I'm going to go into the backlog. All right, I'm going to create a new item and say, okay, create a new project. All right, so this is one of the tasks that I want to do. I can create some subtasks, right? Like say task 1, task 2. I can move this around the board. Like this. So what I want to do now is, okay, I'm going to create a new project. So I have initialized a Git repository. And for those who are using Git long enough, we know that every time we want to do something new, we branch, right? Everything starts with a branch. So from within Team Services, I can say new branch. And I can call this, say, okay, so this is feature, let's say this is feature branch, I'll call this feature 1. And this will be branched from master. Okay, so I've created a new branch. And you can see at the top over here, it gives me the option to clone, right? To clone this project on my desktop. So right now there's nothing, there's only the README file. So I'm gonna say clone. And you can see that there's a whole bunch of IDEs that has inbuilt support. Okay, this is out-of-box support that's provided. If you don't see your IDE here, it doesn't matter. You can still, you know, work with the Git on Team Services. So I'm going to choose Visual Studio. And this launches Visual Studio for me. And okay, so it is prompting me to clone. So I'll say clone. OK, Okay, done. And I'm going to create a new project now. Okay, so I'm going to create ASP.NET project. I'm going to select, okay, Application Insights. So I want to add Application Insights into this project. I'll say okay. I'll choose MVC. I will add some unit tests. And I'll say, okay, host it on Azure. Okay, let me just call this, say, end-to-end DevOps. Is this taken? Okay, I'll say DevOps RG. Let me just add another prefix. Okay, so I'll say create. So this is a wizard that, you know, it's a quick wizard that helps me to create an application, a web application on Azure. So I could log into the Azure portal and do what I just did, but there is an interface from Visual Studio to do so. So Visual Studio has a very tight integration with Azure. Okay, so now my project is being created. I'm going to wait for this to load. Okay, so this has loaded. This is my vanilla ASP.NET application. So, okay, so before I check in, one thing I need to do is to switch the branch, right? Because I'm working on the feature branch instead. So I'm going to switch to the feature branch and I'll say check in. Initial commit. So I'll just do a commit and push. I know it's not really a good practice, but I mean, I'll just, yeah, commit and push within a single stroke. Okay, so now this is pushing my code into my code repository. And let's see if the build has been kicked off, right? Because I have set it up to be a continuous integration. Okay, so you see my build over here, it's called CI. And you see that nothing has been triggered. Any idea why? Yeah, so it was a different branch, right? So I have created the CI to be on my master branch, but I checked in against the feature branch. So one thing we need to do is to merge these two branches, right? So in Git, we do a pull request. How many are not so familiar with Git? Not so, still SVN. All right, okay. So we have to do a pull request. So these terms may not sound so familiar, but basically we're going to merge the branch by doing a pull request. Okay, so from within Visual Studio, and by the way, Visual Studio is actually quite friendly if you are starting with Git, you know, in terms of, you know, getting familiarized with Git. It has a lot of hand-holding in that sense. So I'll go to pull request, and I'll say new pull request. And this brings me back to team services. And I can see that, okay, so this is my pull request. This is basically, I checked in a whole bunch of files, right? My entire web application, actually. I can choose to link it with a few more work items. So I can choose task 2 and maybe even task 1. And I say, okay, create a new pull request. So when I create a new pull request, the team is now then notified to say that, you know, there's a new pull request, can you come in and approve? Which in this case, I happen to be in the same team, so I can go ahead and say approve. So if there are multiple people in the team, you can have multiple approvals, and I can say complete. Right, so I complete the pull request. It gives me the option to delete the feature branch, and I'm just gonna do that. So this completes the merge.
So if you have any conflict, you should resolve it manually.
Yeah, yeah, yes. So this will, yeah, it will be
just
handled
from this window.
Yes, correct. Okay, so if we now come back here, so now you see in progress. Right, now you see the build being kicked off. Right, so if you were to look at this, okay, it's waiting for the build to start, and we will see the build actually happening. So if you were to just go back to edit again, so this is just to share a few more stuff about the build system over here. You will see that, so early on we start off the whole presentation talking about how, you know, you're able to do builds for other systems as well, right, not just .NET. So you can see that there's the end build here, there's Maven, you know, if you are looking at Docker, you know, it can dockerize your apps. So this was the schema compare I was talking about, right? So a task that actually compares your the snapshots of your database. Anyone uses Fortify or have heard of Fortify? So this is by HP, and it is a kind of a, like a penetration testing for your application. So if you have or have used Fortify, you can integrate. Yeah, you can integrate that within your whole pipeline flow as well, right? Gulp, Grunt, Ionic, Jenkins. So yeah, if you're already using Jenkins, you can get team services to trigger a job on Jenkins. So one of the ways that we do it is, so for example, right, let's say you use Git or GitHub, and then you use Jenkins. But you can say that, okay, I want TFS or team services to still pull back the binaries from Jenkins and have team services manage the releases for me, right, the deployments into the different environments. So that's a possibility as well. So yeah, so there's a whole bunch of stuff. You can see I can even do iOS Xcode builds. Okay, so let's see if the build is completed. Should be by now. Yeah, it's completed. Okay, success. So if we were to look at the build summary, so similar to what you saw earlier, right? So, you know, when was it, when it started, when it ended, the test results, these were the tasks that were associated with the build. So you get that full traceability in that sense, right? And if you look under deployments, it says that, okay, so there's no deployments found. You know, do you want to go ahead and create a deployment, right? So one thing about team services, it does gives you that flow, right, from one to one, from one thing to another, quite intuitively. So I'm going to create a release definition now. I'm going to do, so these are all templates. I can choose any one of these templates, and when I choose the template, that means that when I create the build deployment pipeline, it would already have populated the tasks for me, right? If I want to start from scratch, as an empty template, I can just choose empty over here. Then I can just pick and choose the tasks that I want. Okay, so in finishing up, yeah, sure.
For this build, did you configure the build agent beforehand, or is it like you select the build type, say if you want to build Docker, does it build up a build agent for you that contains, say, Docker install?
Okay, so we have a few build agents. Let me get to that in. Yes, correct. So let me show you what happens under the hood in a while. Okay, so let me just create the release first. So while the app is being released, then we can look at some of these things. So I'm gonna say, yep. So over here you can see there's a Jenkins option, right, to be able to pull the binaries from Jenkins. Okay, so I'm going to call this environment dev. I'm going to link my Azure subscription. App service name is, what was it that I created? Yep, I think this was the one. And okay, I should be done. I will just rename this as CD. Save. Okay, so I'll just go ahead and do a release now. So this, I'm doing a manual release, right? So I'm just gonna say, okay, release it into this environment based on this build. Okay, and now Team Services will go ahead and do the deployments for me. Okay, so coming back to that question, so we have this thing here called agent queues. So if I choose that, you can see that there are a few what we call agent pools. Okay, we have a hosted agent pool. So when you create a Team Services account, you get one hosted agent for free. So what this means is that when you do a build, so for example, you have five people in your team, right? All of them queue the builds at about the same time. Because with each Team Services account, you're given the first one is free, right? You can add more if you want. The rest of your team members who have queued slightly later will have to wait for your job to be finished before the rest kicks in. Okay, so this is a hosted agent. That means it's hosted on Azure. You can create your own build agents, right? So you imagine you spin off a VM or you have a machine somewhere in your own office. You download the agents, you copy it into your machine. So it runs as a service or as a console, up to you, you have the choice. So that becomes another agent for you, right? So this will be what we call the on-prem version of the agent. So you can either choose to have a Team Services host the agents for you, so you just purchase more as you go along, or you can just use your own machines as build and deploy agents as well.
So for the hosted agents, you get to choose from the Azure machine templates, and you have the ability to configure on your own, right?
No, so the hosted build agents are fixed. So if you were to look at this, so we, for each agent, we have this thing called capabilities. So capabilities is basically what the agent can build. So for the hosted build agents, you can't change this, right? We from time to time add support into the hosted build agents. So for example, Docker was added recently. You know, you can build your Java stuff. But with your on-prem agents, it's basically what you install on that machine. So if you install Java, you install Node, you install all the different kind of build tools, that build agent that resides on that machine would then have all those capabilities to build what it is you want to build. Yeah.
So for hosted agent, there's no way to install, say, a specific version?
No. Yeah. Yes.
Now you don't need a build controller.
No.
It's done.
That concept is ever since TFS 2015 was released, that we no longer go by the controller concept. It's more of an agent concept. Okay, so let's go back to release. I think the app should have been released by now. And yep, release. Okay, so there, right? From start all the way to release. From scratch to full CI/CD, this is an example of how you can do it. Okay, any questions?
Can you open your application just from this build results?
Okay, good question. Let's see, I have not tried that. I did not output the app service URL, so it does not show here. So I guess one way I could do it is to go into the logs. And actually look at, you know, what was the URL that it was being deployed into. Yeah, so this is the URL, right? But yeah, I think that would be a useful feature to have, right? To just launch the app from there.
Another question, this build result form, can I customize it? Add some dashboard?
this page?
Yeah, yeah.
Like this. Can you customize the
yes,
logs?
Yes, like build summary or whatever. Let's say I have some tools that provide test reports for me.
Yes.
Because customized heavily.
So can I add? So if you have some test tools that you are using, it is up to that tool, right, to provide the relevant information back to Team Services. So for example, if you were to look at some of these tasks over here, Right. Okay, let me go back to the other demo. So let's go back to, I think, Contoso Spots. Okay, so you saw that in the Contoso Spots example, I did a SonarQube analysis, right? So SonarQube is an example of a third-party service that I'm getting to scan my code, right? So you're saying that you want to customize this page to maybe say include those reports over here. So the way that is customized is based on how SonarQube, okay, so in this case, you see that SonarQube provided, you know, not really a lot of detail, right? Just a little bit, and you can click on the link to view the full SonarQube report, which actually brings you to the SonarQube instance where you view everything in full detail, right? So if you were to look at the tasks over here, the amount of information that you see in the build summary is dependent on how SonarQube, in this case, SonarQube was the one who created this this task that you see here, is how they develop it, right? So they can choose to display as much or as little data as they want. It depends on the third-party developer.
There's some options to write to this console log summary, some text, some URLs.
Not really. It depends on the task that you're using, yeah, and what how much information that task chooses to dump out. Yeah.
But
in
summary, I can't replace to my own template, for example.
No. Not for the team services one, at least. If it's TFS, you probably could. I'm not really sure. Because in TFS, you could go down to the code level and make some modifications, right? In the team services one, it's provided to you as a service. You can't really make that change. Yeah.
Yep. To deploy to a local machine,
yeah, you can do that. Yeah, you can deploy locally. I know that. Okay, the examples I show you are all cloud based because it's easier to show, rather than to set up. You know, yeah, you can deploy. You can deploy on prem onto your VMs on cloud. Yeah. Yeah.
And what is considered as build artifacts? Some binaries.
Yeah. So, for example, okay, let's look at these builds. So. Let's see this build, right? So this is a build summary page. I can see these artifacts link over here. So this were, okay, let me say explore. So these are all the files, right? In this case, it's a web deployment files that I have packaged as a build artifact.
So you set up what you consider to be an artifact and just edit
The artifacts is basically the output of a solution build. Yep. So like if in your current desktop you open Visual Studio, you right click, you build, whatever that is built out, that is essentially the artifacts. It'll be the same thing as you will get in team services. Whatever that is being built is the artifacts. Yeah. In this case you can see that I have a few, you see this zip file, that's because for my build task, when I am doing my Visual Studio build, I actually passed in some arguments to package it as a zip. So if you look at my, so this is my solution build. So this actually, you know, basically achieves the same thing as you would have, you know, if you were to try to right click on a solution and build on your machine. So you can see over here, MS build arguments. I passed in some arguments so that it kind of packages it in the zip file. Otherwise, you would see your usual, your DLLs or your EXEs as artifacts. Yep.
Is it possible to, say, have multiple agents deploying on a single Windows instance?
Multiple agents deploying on a single Windows instance.
That you want to build your integration environment, so you have one for the main branch and another one for the feature branch.
Right. I don't think so, because for that to happen, so If you're deploying on-prem, right? If you're deploying on-prem, the on-prem deployment happens over what we call the WinRM protocol, right? Windows Remote Management or Secure PowerShell, right? So it uses this port 5986. Okay, so when that port is already in use, it is unlikely that another agent would be able to communicate through that same port to that same machine from multiple sources. So I don't think so. I have not tried, but I don't think so.
As far as I know, you can choose which port to use for agent in previous version of TFS at least.
Yeah, I have not tried that with the newer ones. Yeah.
So previously, you make sure you can run several instances.
Any other questions?
Sure.
We do the same thing with TFS. It has to be TFS update, TFS 2015 update 2 or later. 3, is it? Is it 3? The one with the release management, is it?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Update 3.
Update 3 is already there.
Ah, okay, okay. So update 2, you do not have the release management. There is, right? Yeah. Then update 2 should work. My recollection is update 2, so maybe 2 or 3. Yeah. But then again, if you're installing, might as well just get the latest. Latest, by the way, is 2017, not 2015. Yeah.
Sorry.
Oh, yeah. 17 is out, yeah. 17 is in production. Visual Studio 2017 is not it's not RTM yet, but TFS 2017 is RTM. Yeah.
And what about for this management? A single product. Microsoft wants to continue to just stop. So everything now integrated into TFS.
Yes. That is the direction.
Okay.
So the last version of TFS that you get the separate release management was 2013, I think. Mm-hmm. Yeah, 20. So yeah. Yeah.
And if, for example, the last step, this UI test, have failed, will the build fail?
Up to you. You can, you know, it's up to you to decide. So, okay, so for example, so this is an example of a UI test that failed. So I can say, so in QA, right? So this is the, this is the UI test, right? This is the UI test. I can say continue on error. And I check this checkbox. So by default, this is unchecked. So if it fails, everything stops, right? So if you check this, it will still continue down whatever it needs to execute.
And the build will be yellow?
Yes, yellow. So the build is successful, but your test failed, essentially. Yeah. But if you don't check this, right, if you don't say continue on error, then even though the deployment is successful, but your test failed, it will show red. Yeah, I mean that's the logic of this checkbox.
And always run, what is it?
Also, that means if it fails, you always cause it to run.
Right.
Yeah.
And what tries do user needs to add steps to the build definition?
What rights?
Right. I mean permissions.
Project contributor rights.
Project contributor.
I think that there's a whole matrix, permissions matrix online. I mean, I can't recall, but yeah, you can go and check it out. Yeah. Yes.
What level of containerization support does this pipeline has to offer? Like the question was just mentioned, deploy multiple artifacts to one agent. Can we do like deploy, say, multiple containers to this agent, or say we multiple containers simultaneously on the
hosting engine? Yeah, so you can. So you can choose to parallelize your deployments and your builds. So let me see. So that is somewhere deployment conditions. I think it's this one over here. I'm not too sure. It could be this one. So you're able to parallelize your deployments in that sense. But of course, you then have to weigh between the amount of available build agents you have versus how much you're actually trying to deploy. Yeah. Okay. Any other questions? Yeah, sure.
I remember you talking about, you know, setting programmers to bug jail and stuff in the last talk. Oh, do you track, is it possible to track, is this tool as well? Like, how is your team, what's the team performance in terms of...
No, not with this. So usually what happens is we will export the raw data to Power BI and then we track it from there.
Oh.
Yeah, not from within this, yeah. Okay, any other questions? If not, I mean, I have presented what I wanted, I've came to show you guys. You can just, yeah, have a casual discussion. If not, thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Yep, thank you. Thank you.